hello to Lisbeth in Lexington, Kentucky, on Real Life Radio. I've been there. Hello, Lisbeth in Lexington.
Hello.
Hey, welcome.
I love the program. I'm not a Catholic, but I consider myself a follower of Jesus. I'm just trying to learn more every day.
Uh-huh.
Lisbeth,
so I have a question about...
Go ahead.
What is the current Catholic understanding of purgatory?
Okay. Purgatory is the final purification that we experience at the end of this life in order to free us from any outstanding consequences of our sins. The guilt of our sins, certainly our eternal sins, has already been forgiven, or you wouldn't even be going to purgatory. But there can be other consequences that need to be dealt with, and it purges us, it makes us pure and ready for the full glory of heaven, because nothing impure is going to enter heaven. And so if we still have some impurity that needs to be dealt with at the end of this life, that's where God takes care of it. The church doesn't have a specific teaching about precisely how God does this. There's a particular passage in Scripture in 1 Corinthians 3 that associates the image of fire with the testing of our works, and talks about how if a person's works end up being burned up by that fire, then the person will be saved, but it'll be like escaping through flames. So that may give us a little bit of an indication of what purgatory is like, though presumably that's a metaphor, since we're talking about spiritual realities here, and spiritual things don't literally burn up. But nevertheless, even in this life, fire is often used for purifying things, for refining metals, for example. You know, the scriptures talk about the refiner's fire, where a refiner, a person who refined metals, would heat up the metals in order to get the impurities out of them. And so it's natural, regardless of specifically how God does it, for the scriptures to use that kind of imagery as an imagery of purification, which is what purgatory is. The church also doesn't say how long purgatory takes. It may be stretched out over time. The way we understand it, it may be something analogous to that. It could all happen in a flash. Something that some theologians, including Pope Benedict, before he was pope, speculated that it had a kind of existential duration rather than a temporal duration. So it's something we experience without it necessarily being mappable over time, you know, with a watch or something like that. So we don't claim to know a whole lot about it, but we do know that God's going to purify us of whatever remaining impurities need to be dealt with at the end of our life if we die in his friendship, and we leave the specific manner and timing of that up to him. The church also understands that we can help people who are experiencing this purification, however it takes place, by praying for them. And we see an example of that in a book that's in the Catholic Old Testament called Second Maccabees. It's something that our Jewish friends also do. They pray for the purification of the dead. And most Christians down through world history have done that as well. Although in the last 500 years, those Christians who have belonged to the Protestant community have typically not done so. Although even some of them have, like C.S. Lewis, for example.
How's that, Lisbeth?
Oh, that's great. Thank you so much.
No problem. Anytime we can help, okay?
Yep.
All righty. Thank
Good,
you.
Strong, bye-bye. Bye-bye, Lisbeth. Good, strong Catholic community there in Lexington.
I've been there. Yeah,
me too. It's located kind of southeast from the buckle of the Bible Belt.